everybody. Thank you for tuning in again to the Panther Show. My name is Eric, or Baba Eric, and I have a special guest, Miss Kyera. And I just want to let you know that we are representing the Betty Shabazz International Charter School, specifically Barbara A. Sizemore Academy. Matter of fact, we are the Barbara A. Sizemore Academy. We're located at 6547 South Stewart Avenue, Chicago, Illinois, 60621. You can also see us on the net at www.bsics.org, or you can reach us at 773-651-1661. So once again, I have young Kyera here with me today. How you doing today?
I'm doing very well.
And Kyera, as you know, she has hosted the last two shows. She is just co-hosting with me today. And today, what do we want to talk about today, Kyera?
We're going to talk about technology.
Technology. So we had a brief conversation last week about technology and some of the ways we use technology. I just kind of wanted to get Kyera in on the conversation a little bit because, you know, we're living in a technology-filled age right now. And brothers like myself, we grew up without technology, at least a limited technology. So a lot has changed over the last, like, 30 years. And I just wanted to kind of talk to Kyera and some of the young folks today about how they use technology and how has technology, advanced their life. So, I mean, Kyera, what kind of devices do you own?
Computer, a tablet, and a phone.
And which one of those do you probably use the most?
A computer.
Computer. So tell me, like, what are some of the things that you do with the computer? Like, I know you do stuff at school, you do stuff at home. Like, what are some of the things you like to do on the computer?
Watch YouTube and look up, like, ways, like, dance moves and stuff that I can do. And Moby Max.
And Moby Max. What is Moby Max?
It is an educational app that helps you learn and gives you better knowledge than you have already. It shows you, like, the way of things. Like, it has reading, math, science, social studies, you name it.
Okay. So, I mean, speaking of the computer, I mentioned last week that I grew up with really pretty much without a computer. Do you think that's something you can do? Do you think you could actually live and survive without a computer or some of these devices?
Yeah, I can. I'm a book person. I'm not really a like technology to read. Person.
I know a lot of people don't read. I really don't even read that much, to be honest with you. I know you're a writer because in my class you like to write, and with writing comes reading. So what are some of the things that you like to read and write? Like, what are some of the books you've read?
Or I'm working on this story called The Creepy Doll.
Story you made up?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
And because I like creepy things. So, and I also like to read books like ghost stories, so I'm more like a scary person. And I have books that I had since I was in, like, first grade. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I'm a book hoarder.
I mean, is there any, I know you say you like creepy things, so you like to read, like, horror things or watch horror movies and things like that?
I watch so many horror movies with my mom and my brother and my sister. My dad is not really a horror movie person. He's a sci-fi person, and I get the sci-fi and horror from both my parents.
So tell me this. I want to just tell me a little bit about the school you're at Barbara A. Sizemore Academy. I mean, how much of technology do you all, like, use over there at the school?
We use a lot of technology. We have computers, we have tablets, we have mini tablets, and we use those a lot to do Moby Max or to, like, look up stuff on the internet and stuff. So we use a lot.
Well, tell me this. Are there some things, like, I know last week we mentioned about bullying and cyberbullying, but are there things like the technology, like, that we use, is there, like, a downside to that, like a bad side to that?
Yes, it can melt a child's brain. People use more technology than they use books. They use technology to look up everything. They don't use books or their own minds. So my
question I asked earlier, I mean, do you think you could survive without technology? You say you think you could. Now, just to put yourself in my shoes for a second, like back in the, let's say the late 70s, early 80s, when we had to walk around and go drop a dime in the payphone, or we had to memorize phone numbers, or walk around with a piece of paper in your pocket. I mean, can you wrap your mind around that? Do you really think that you would really be able to survive with no cell phone, not being able to Google something, or your teacher say, "Hey, I need you to research this," and you couldn't just like pop up Google? You had to go to the library. You really think you could handle something like that?
This is a really easy question. I actually can, because that's why paper was invented. I mean, you can write stuff down. I mean, you could go over your friend's house. You don't have to call them all the time. It's not like rocket science to use your two legs that you were born with. So.
All right. It looks like we have a caller. Caller, are you there?
I am here, and yes, you do have a caller.
Hey, what's up?
Wonderful. It's a great show. Listen, for a smart young woman like that, I got to say there is a lot of promise for you to do writing for the internet, for television shows, for books, movies. There's so much possibility, so many possibilities for someone as smart as you to get out there and make something fantastic for the rest of us to watch. You know, those Netflix specials don't write themselves. So keep it up.
Thank you, caller. So he mentioned something about writing for movies and plays and stuff. I mean, is that something, a career that you possibly would like to pursue?
There are two careers, actually. A dancing career and an author. I can probably get a book published or so.
Yeah, that's good. Speaking of dancing, I'm gonna go into one of Kyra's videos real quick. Let's check it out real quick. She over here dancing still. Now, I just wanted to show that real quick. I apologize for the speed of that. For some reason, when we uploaded it to YouTube, it doesn't play it back the right speed. But you can kind of see some of the moves that Kyra has, which are pretty good. You know, I want to ask you, though, like, you say you mentioned you want to do, like, writing and stuff and dancing as a career. When you graduate high school and you move on to college, which one of those are you going to like major in one and minor in the other? Which one do you really put forth that you really want to pursue the most, writing or dancing? Because I ain't going to lie, it's kind of hard to break into the dance business. I mean, it was kind of easier back in the 90s and early 2000s. There was a lot of music videos out, a lot of people auditioning for stuff. I mean, dancing is still in, but where do you think you'll fit in? I mean, what kind of, you know, education, or I didn't say education, but which one do you really want to pursue the most, writing or dance?
See, you caught me on that one. I think I want to do both.
Both? That's good. I mean, I guess ain't nothing wrong with that. You know, we have different things going on at the school. We have like showcases. Can you tell us about like one of the showcases? What was the last showcase that you were a part of?
So it was one of the showcases that we did. I was in the dance one. It was one where we were like doing the things that the people in Africa do. Like they wash the vegetables and dry their clothes and hang them up on the racks and stuff. That's what we did. And I had my own solo.
Mm-hmm. It got everybody. I might have to upload that for next week. Maybe we'll show your solo performance. Who is your dance teacher over there at Barbe Sizemore Academy?
Mama Koya, she is a great dancer.
Does she, you all, not only do you learn dance, but you learn, does she give you like kind of like a little small history lesson about where these dances come from?
Mm-hmm.
Like, can you share a little bit of that? Like, where do some of these dances originate from?
Some of them we get them from Ghana, and some we get from Africa. It's like, and then like she teaches like the languages they speak, mm-hmm. and we also do songs that they speak. So
that's good. I mean, tell me this: over at Barbe Sizemore Academy, it's a very African cultural environment. We learn a little bit of Swahili. We are. Uniform colors are red, black, and green, and I think that that's very important for our young African Americans to learn a little bit about our culture. I just want to ask you, as a youth, you know, how important do you think that is for us to learn about our heritage and culture?
It is very important because some people are really confused about where they come from, and then,
correct.
Like, they say that they're from that place, but then they're actually not. Mm-hmm. And, like, some people want to be a part of a different culture, but they're not. And, mm-hmm. I mean, so it's kind of weird to me, so.
I mean, it is very important for us. This goes out to all you young people out there. It's really not about black and white and this and that. It's just all about being proud of where you come from and where your ancestors come from and learning a little bit of that history. And that's one reason why I enjoy working at Barbe Sizemore Academy, part of the Betty Shabazz International Charter School System, because a lot of our young youth these days, they don't have a clue of where their ancestors came from. They don't have a clue of, you know, you think of Africa. I'm gonna ask you, when you first started coming up and learning about Africa, what were some of the stereotypes you thought of Africa? What did you think about the African people over in Africa?
I felt a little bad for them because Mama Koya showed us this movie,
mm-hmm.
and it was very tragic. And so a lot of people say Africa is poor, but it's kind of the richest country, so.
Yeah, so that's what I was getting at, is that a lot of people, when they think of Africa, they automatically think starvation. They think of, you know, people being poor and a lot of violence. And it is over there. Don't get me wrong. You know, that Africa is a troubled continent right now. And we know why, but but a lot of people don't understand that Africa is a very rich company, a country, or a continent. A lot of resources come out of Africa. The diamonds that you're wearing in your ear, 9 times out of 10, came from Africa. The ingredients, ingredients.
And stuff. Like the minerals and stuff comes from
minerals. A lot of minerals. Some of the minerals that are in your cell phone actually come from Africa. There are a lot of things that come from Africa that they just really people don't know about or don't really give credit to Africa, because Africa is very rich in just materials and resources. Of course, they're being robbed and raped for a lot of their materials, but it's just something that a lot of young people should know and learn about.
A lot of people take advantage of Africa. Like, they say, like, oh, and then, like, they be so rude and disrespectful mm-hmm. to the way people speak and how they act and what they wear. And it's not all about what other people think. It's about how you think of yourself. And if you take advantage of African people, then you must be really... Because, I mean, they African people are the reason of the clothing we wear, the cell phones we use, and everything.
Yeah, so. A lot of people need to give credit to Africa. Let me give credit once again to who sponsors this show. We are representing the Barbara A. Sizemore Academy, and we are located at 6547 South Stewart Avenue, Chicago, Illinois. You can reach us at the web at, I'm sorry, www.bsix, that's bsics.org. You can also reach us on the phone at 773-651-1661. I want to thank you again. I'm about to pass the reins over to our new guest. But before I do that, I want to play one more video that I love that we produced over at the Barber A. Sizemore Academy. So just stand by real quick.
Turn up. Trump is racist. He trying to end our lives, but we still strive. So we look ahead of time, so we won't commit no crime.
And the things that rhyme, and the time you know we gon' fail, I can tell. Faith is the thing that keeps you alive against black lives, and keep the time, it rhymes.
Never die, always try. Faith can keep you alive. With our black lives, all we do is strive, 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 and strive, strive.
Black lives always strive. All lives always strive. Black 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 lives always strive.
Yo, let's get it.
Pause the video.
Hello, I'm Bryson Oriel. Today with me, I have Baba J, a gym teacher at Barber A. Sizemore. Being a gym teacher, I want to ask you some questions. Why did you want to become a gym teacher?
Well, Bryson, originally, I didn't want to become a gym teacher. I didn't want to teach. Mm. But I went to school, and in college, I studied biology. I played basketball at Tennessee State University. I went on from Tennessee State University to Chicago State University. Through that whole process, you know, I started a family, a couple of children. Things change, you know. My wife is a doctor. She's a dentist, doctor of dental surgery. I was on the medical track as well. But like I say, things change, and so you got to get in where you fit in.
Yeah.
And this is where I fit in. I was gym teacher. I've been a physical science teacher. I've been a math teacher, and back to gym teacher.
I know that being a gym teacher, you have a basketball team. The basketball team. Do you think they've grown from which they first started?
Absolutely. That's exactly what we focus on is growth.
Growth.
Okay. Yeah. So, you know, I'm athletic director at the school, and I have several teams, basketball, track. We've done volleyball. We have a soccer team, and we're looking to add other teams and sports that we can accommodate in the school.
Do you push them to eat anything specifically to stay fit?
Always.
Like?
Always. Fit in life. My new quote to them or statement of life is, do something for your body today that your body will thank you for in the future.
Wow.
So that's one of the ways that I get them to think about our focus in physical education now is fitness. And we're doing endurance tests, strength tests, flexibility tests. So, you know, children don't really understand why it's important. So I try to get them to see the importance of that.
That's cool. What other sports other than basketball do you encourage people to play to stay fit?
All sports.
All sports.
Yeah. That's another one of those get in where you fit in. You do what you like. You like to run. You find sports where you can run a lot. Track, of course, is an obvious one. But most sports involve a lot of cardiovascular endurance. And soccer, as you know, is a sport because you played for our soccer team.
Yeah.
And I played very talented soccer player, I must say. Very aggressive, team-oriented. When we picked teams, everybody wanted Bryson. Get Bryson, man, get Bryson. So soccer is a sport that we play. Basketball is a sport that requires running. And so we do those sports. with the knowledge that they're going to help our bodies get stronger.
Saying that, do you think sports is an important part of life, or just exercising and generally? In general?
Exercising in general, because I don't really play sports. In fact, you know, Bryce and I played today. I played with my team today. We were short today in practice in numbers, and we were setting up a 4-on-4. One guy was going to watch, and I'm standing there, and I decided I'm going to play today. So when I decide to play, the kids are, oh, Baba J is going to play, but your wheels aren't what they used to be, Bryson, but, you know, I can hang with some 8th graders. But
at least that was a good exercise for you once in a while.
Absolutely. So I say that to say that I don't necessarily play sports, Bryson, to stay in shape. I do high-intensity interval training, calisthenics, more using my body weight to create strength, natural strength, as opposed to weights. I use my body weight.
Okay, cool. Other than the exercise you said, what other exercises do you push your students to do?
The high-intensity interval training.
High-intensity.
Is a set. There's several ways to use it. There's this thing called Tabata training.
Tabata.
Where you'll have three different exercises. For instance, you'll have a crunch. You will have a pike or a plank position where you could do a plank jack. Is a different exercise than your crunches. Crunches are developed for an exercise that develop your abdominals.
Yeah,
your core muscles. The plank jack is also an exercise to develop your core muscles. And then you can do another core developing exercise like squat thrust.
Squat thrust.
Yeah, and you put those three together and you do them over a certain amount of time with a certain amount of rest. And so we've gone through those types of trainings with the children where we've got these stations that we go to and different exercises with different time limits. And very exciting, very fun for the children.
Really cool. Well, hello, if you're now just tuning in, I'm Bryson Royale, and a teacher, a gym teacher actually, at Barbara Sizemore. If you would like, contact them, 6547 S. Stewart Avenue, or Chicago, Illinois, 60621. Our website, www.bsics.org. Or you can call us at 773-651-161. Thank you for being here. I'm a student there. Yeah, your training is really, really hard. Have me breathing a lot.
Yeah,
thank you. Do you push the teachers to exercise too?
I'm always talking to the teachers. I don't push them, but I just say things, you know, about what I'm doing, how I eat, you know, so that they know that I am serious about health and I'm conscious of what I'm eating. And, you know, as adults, you kind of see what's best for you as you grow older or whatever, and as you want to seek health and you see that you can do it, you know. A lot of people may not think that, oh, that can't be me. And from the aspect of looking at it like, okay, that person's skinny or slim, and he can eat that or he can eat this and that. I can't eat those things. Over time, you begin to realize you can slim down. You can eat different, but you just have to sometimes have an example. So I won't just come to someone overtly, hey, man.
Well, you're not like that.
Yeah, so, you know, you just kind of ease it in. I'm always talking health. I'm always eating, trying to eat the best I can eat. Not perfect.
Yeah.
But I try to get better every day, which is something we teach the children.
Yeah, not everybody can be perfect.
Right.
But, yeah, it's cool. It's nice to be there. Oh, it looks like we have a caller. Caller, are you there?
Hi.
Hello.
Yeah, I just heard your school was getting renewed for charter.
Yeah, we had a big... We had a big celebration today, actually, in Circle, for our school getting renewed. What do you have to... Yeah, that's, thank you. What do you have to say about that?
Yeah, charter renewal. We were up for renewal this year. We were observed by the Illinois State Charter Commission.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a process we've been going through. We've gone through it before.
Mm-hmm.
And it was very interesting to see how Illinois kind of observed us and judged us. Gave us obstacles to overcome, gave us a kind of like a roadmap to follow to get better. And we met the challenge. And yesterday we went in for the final judgment. A few of our teachers spoke at the commission, at the renewal hearing. and we actually succeeded. And it was a great time for us. Our principal, Mama Jocelyn Mills, who is an excellent administrator, who is very intelligent, has led the charge the last 2 years towards this renewal. And she's done an outstanding job. You spoke about Moby Max in our first interview. And you've been involved with Moby Max.
Yeah, Moby Max, yeah.
And she's very intelligent and very sharp on finding things that you can use in technology for children to improve themselves.
Yeah, I think Moby Max is a good thing. But thank you for being here, Bubba J.
Absolutely.
And thank you guys for tuning in.
It's great. Loved it.